Good morning-ish. My name is Mendel from Previva Health Group. It's very nice to be here. And this is a really great follow because Angie talked about a lot of really important things. And I see chronic care management, the actual program, as really a way to execute on a lot of those really important things. So the purpose of today is to kind of run through the program. I tried to split it into three sections. So we're going to try to talk about why, what, and how, and in that order specifically, because if we don't know why we're doing something, then it's hard to figure out what it is, and even harder to figure out how to get it done. And a lot of the why, honestly, Angie went through, and a lot of really important quality metrics that we want to be putting into place. But really, it comes down to, in essence, chronic care management, it's a preventative health program. That's what it is, right? And the focus on prevention is something that goes back to, for thousands of years, ancient wisdom. Many years ago in the Torah, it says in the Hebrew, "V'nishmartem me'od l'naf shoseichem," you shall guard your life exceedingly carefully. That's in the Bible in Deuteronomy, to guard proactively your life, exercising is something that's encouraged, and just looking out for your life in a preventive fashion. A couple thousand years later, famously from Benjamin Franklin, an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. And we all know that to be true. And more recently, a noted American rapper, artist, and entrepreneur Kanye West, who is said to have said that the chronic care management program from CMS has truly been a game changer for both patients and physicians alike. That's a joke. That is not that one is not true. But we don't need ancient wisdom, old philosophers, or even modern day rappers and fashion icons to tell us something that each and every one of you sitting in this room know. And that is that prevention works. And you know, the problem is so often we're focusing on reactively healing our patients, and our resources are spread so thin that we forget to focus on the preventative piece. And that's what this program really does. This program gives us the opportunity to, it gives us resources, whether that's utilizing internal resources or if that's leveraging a vendor, as we'll kind of get into. But whichever way you want to spin it and whichever way you want to do it, this program gives you both the revenue and the path and the blueprint to really getting these things done, and a lot of the things that Angie talked about as far as getting that data in, making your patients feel like, I think Kate said, feel like they you care about them, because obviously you do. So at the end of the day, what we're looking for is better patient experience. This is what you should get from running a chronic care management program: better patient experiences, better patient outcomes, fewer complications, fewer hospitalizations. And this is a big one: the better data on your patients. If you have a structured program where you're reaching out to your patients on a monthly basis, you're talking to them, we're going to get into the care plan that we create, and you're using that to really touch base with them on their health goals, their health challenges, running through the medications that they're taking, see if there's anything that they should be telling their doctor. You're taking all that in, you're documenting, and as you do that, you'll be able to run those reports and have a lot of that data ready to go. And specifically, the bottom point is also more revenue to your practice, which is obviously very important. So let's get into the what. What is the program? So specifically, we're talking about, it's going to be CPT code G0511. That's for RHCs and FQHCs. And this is for chronic care management services. You need to be spending a minimum of 20 minutes, and that's by clinical staff, that's directed by a physician, and per calendar month. And there's a number of elements that are required. First of all, from the patient perspective, they have to have multiple, at least two chronic conditions. And those conditions are expected to last at least 12 months. Now, I believe FQs is only one as of a little bit ago, but the general program is two conditions.
What's that?
Yeah, and that's a little different. It's very similar, but it's 30 minutes instead of
same code. Same code, same minutes.
So, but you would spend the 30 minutes instead of the 20?
One code description, 20 minutes.
So what would differentiate the two? CCM and PCM?
Nothing.
Okay, so it's just called another name. And then the comprehensive care plan, you want that to be established, implemented, revised, or monitored. And we're going to get into really, you know, what that looks like, but that care plan really becomes the center of truth for the team to be able to reach out to that patient, and that should be really the guide and the map for the chronic care management program for that patient on a monthly basis, and it should be updated once every 6 months. Let's talk about practitioner eligibility. So who can actually provide chronic care management? Obviously doctors, but also some non-physician practitioners. You have certified nurse midwives, clinical nurse specialists, nurse practitioners, and there's a couple of those in the audience. Raise your hand. Yep. And PAs. So now this next part is from CMS, and it's fairly important because this gives you the ability. CMS understands that, and this is applicable especially today with the great resignation going on, everybody quitting their jobs and going everywhere, and we have inflation and post-COVID, and there's a lot of challenges with staffing, and sometimes people don't have the internal resources to really get the program done. And CMS understands that. So the CCM service that are not provided personally by the billing practitioner are provided by clinical staff, and that is under the direction of the billing practitioner. So you can have a team, and that's where these many CCM vendors come in, where you can have a team that is working together with you, and we'll get into what makes a vendor a good vendor, but you can leverage either a vendor or do it yourself. Even if you're doing it yourself, if you have people off-site, then that is fine, as long as they're working under the general supervision of the practitioner. There's a list of examples of what is considered chronic conditions. The list is fairly long, and unfortunately, pretty much every patient that is going to be eligible for the program that's on Medicare. And by the way, there are other plans that are starting to pay for this more and more. What we typically do is we'll take a plan, we'll service a couple patients, we'll bill it out, see how it comes back in. But there's more and more plans that are actually paying for this program, some even much more than Medicare, which is interesting. But unfortunately, most patients will have those two chronic conditions. Obviously, you need to double check that, go through every patient, and make sure, run your eligibility checks, and make sure that they've got at least the two chronic conditions. Patient consent. So it's important to get consent from the patient, informed consent from the patient. There's a list of things that you have to go through together with the patient in order for them to consent to the program. And all those things have to be documented. So either the patient will physically sign a form, but it can also be verbally agreed to but documented. Now, an interesting workflow difference with RHCs is that although the consent from the patient can be verbal and then documented, but it must be done directly under the supervision of the practitioner, so that has to be actually on site. The consent has to be obtained on site where the billing practitioner is going to be. So in that case, if you are utilizing a vendor, then you'll probably want to work that into your workflow and make sure that all the parties are doing their part to make sure that you have a fully compliant and effective program. Here's a couple of the points that you want to go through: the availability of CCM services and applicable cost sharing. That's a good point. If you want to make sure that if a patient does not have a secondary, they know that they're going to be responsible for that copay. Newsflash, they're not going to be happy. So that's something that you might want to look at. Only one practitioner can furnish and be paid for CCM. So this is slowly becoming more and more popular. I think COVID indirectly affected this a lot because COVID kind of forced both patients and doctors to acclimate to the idea that you can have a person that is working at the practice and they're not physically at the front desk and they're still working for the practice. So it's helped a lot of patients be comfortable with the idea of general telehealth and that kind of thing. So as it does become more popular, I think we're going to start seeing wars between specialists and the primaries and who's billing first. But at the end of the day, only one provider can bill for chronic care management, and if someone else bills for it and you're trying to, you'll get denied. Third thing, the right to stop CCM services at every time. By raise of hand, who has ever signed up for a subscription service, tried to unsubscribe, and was just impossible, right? Everyone, right? I think just a couple weeks ago, there was this, it was some web security, I don't know what it was, but there was something that apparently I had signed up to, and it must have taken me through 10 or 15 loops. Would you like to unsubscribe? Yes, I'd like to unsubscribe. Are you sure? Do you want to just move your renewal date? No, I'm sure. Okay, fine, but you know, we could do this, we could do that. Is it the money? Is it the time? Trying to get you to stay on. It's a very short-sighted game. With our patients, we want our patients to be happy. We want our patients to find value in the program. The program is about, at the end of the day, giving your patient, like we said, your patients a better experience with your practice, giving your patients better access to you. The number one issue when we talk to patients is access to their clinic. They're calling, and sometimes they spend hours on hold, and they just can't get that appointment. So what a CCM program does for you is it allows you to have a care coordinator that has just the right amount of patients, that they have time for every patient, and the patients can call that care coordinator and get things done, whether it's the general, obviously, updating the care plan, but if they're calling back in, they can request an appointment. They can request for a medication refill request. You can help them out in a lot of different ways that the typical front desk, who's overloaded with work and is probably really spread thin, can't get done. So your patient should end up walking away with more access to you, and then you have more data on your patients. Because if your patient doesn't show up and you're not doing this program for 3 months or 6 months or once, you know, if they only come in once a year, then you don't have data on your patients. But if you're running a program like chronic care management, then you are proactively and actively reaching out to them, once again, documenting every conversation, every correspondence, documenting separately each instance of care. And this way, you have better data on your patients, and your patients have better access to you. So my point is that it should be a valuable program to the patient. And if it is not a valuable program to the patient, they should not be on it. So take them off. If a patient, I would just, side note, I would recommend if a patient calls in and they say, you know, we don't want to be on the program anymore, just run through what the value of the program is one more time, explain it to them. If they still don't want to be on the program, immediately take them off. And the reason why I say that is sometimes you have patients that don't fully connect the two dots. We once had a patient call in, and her care coordinator's name was Heather, and she calls the manager, his name's Jessica, and she says, Jessica, I want to be off chronic care management. And she says, no worries, we're going to take you off the program. And she says, yeah, I don't need this, because if I need anything, I could just call Heather. So Jessica said, well, that's the same thing. So would you like to stay? She wants to stay on. So just make sure that they know that you're talking about the program, that they understand that they're talking about the specific program. But if they don't want to be on the program, don't make it difficult. Take them off the program. You're not going to win in the end. Informed patient consent only needs to be obtained once prior to starting CCM, and that's with each practitioner. So if they switch doctors, then obviously you would get that consent again. But that only has to happen once. And once again, make sure that's documented and that's on there. And document. Another important piece, I would hope, is anyone not on an EHR in the room? Probably can't ask that. Who is on an EHR in the room? Because no one's going to raise their hand if they're not today. But unfortunately, there are still some providers that are not. And like Kate was saying, I think it was ACO that they said by the end of the century, everyone's going to be part of some accountable care organization. Yeah. That by the end of the century, we're all going to be in some sort of value-based care setting. So definitely a very, very small, tiny step of that is being on an EHR. So that's a real requirement for the program. If you have someone talking to you and they try finding loopholes and, well, we can start something and we can put, just don't mess with it, no gray areas. If you're not on an EHR, get on an EHR, but everyone here is, so moving on. All right, comprehensive care plan. So you want to build a care plan, and it should be in the name, comprehensive care plan. It should go through the patient's health goals, their health challenges, and really get into the nitty-gritty. What's really stopping them from achieving their goals? Angie was saying earlier she wants to drink more water. Well, what's stopping you from drinking more water? A patient should be reducing their salt intake. Well, perhaps they're simply afraid that food is not going to taste good without salt. There's probably some real simple, very human reasons why a patient is not going to be compliant. And if you can talk to them on a human level and really get personal with it, then chances are you can brainstorm together with them. And again, the purpose of this is to really partner with the patient on their own health. We want to empower the patient to take control and to work, you know, to work together with their doctor to improve on their health. And if the patient has goals and they feel accountable for it and they want to move those goals forward, then they will. If they feel like they're, you know, every time they show up to the doctor, it's like they're going to get on the bad list if they answer the question wrong, or if they feel that there's a wrong answer to the question of, are you drinking enough water or are you reducing your salt intake, then you're not going to get accurate results. So that the comprehensive care plan should be really personal. Get it into a conversation with the patient, create those goals together, and then talk about the challenges, and then make small goals to achieve the larger goal. Here's some of the bullet points that the care plan should include, like a problem list, expected outcomes, measurable goals. And measurable is really a key word, because a lot of goals are very vague. And we had one goal that that was kind of getting auto-populated, and the goal was to not have a heart attack. And you know, until unfortunately the patient is no longer, that's going to be an ongoing goal. That's not really. So take goals. And sometimes it's a very easy tweak. If it's exercise more, maybe make it specific. Exercise twice a week this month. And if I did that, then I achieved my goal this month, and then started again the next month. But make small, measurable, and achievable goals. Don't leave it super open-ended and super broad, because then, like we said, the very big part of this is on the flip side, you should be able to pull data. You should look back at your program in 6 months and say, hey, here's all these amazing outcomes that we've achieved with these patients. We can now look at, you know, that they've had fewer hospitalizations and ER visits. And then on the positive level, you can say, hey, look at this track. Look what we've done with these patients. We've had them achieve all these little goals. But if they're not measurable and they're just big, amazing goals, then that's not going to do anything for the patient. And once again, the program has to be valuable to the patient. Otherwise, it's not going to work for you as their doctor. All right, planned interventions, medication management, that's an important one. You want to make sure that you're both on the same page as far as what medications they're taking. Specifically, if you're the primary, could be the patient went to specialists and they didn't tell you about it, and now maybe they're taking medication that you're not aware of, or they're not taking their medications. We've all seen that, right? So we want to make sure we're on top of that. Community and social services. So Angie talked about a church. I'll tell you a small story. A couple months ago, we celebrated the holiday of Passover. And I had about a week and a half before, one of the care coordinators and her manager walked into my office, both of them not Jewish, and they said, we have a patient and he's totally distraught. And I said, what's going on? And they said, well, his whole family has passed away. He doesn't have anyone. And the one person he used to talk to was his therapist. And his therapist went on some vacation to Hawaii, never came back. Don't know what happened to him. So he has no one in the world. But that's not what's getting him down today. What's getting him down today is Passover is typically, it's a family affair. It's the Passover Seder, something that's celebrated with family. And this year, he has nobody to celebrate with. And he was really distraught about it. So they asked me, they said, you know, you're Jewish. Is there anything that we can do? So luckily, I'm aware of a social services almost organization in Judaism. It's called Chabad, and they typically have centers all over. And so I was able to find a center, and they typically have resources for Jewish holidays, and a very common program is to have a public Seder where anyone can come and enjoy the Seder. So I happened to find a public Seder that was happening. I called the rabbi, and it was a 6-minute walk from this patient's house, and I called the rabbi and I said, listen, I need the information on your Seder. Can't give you the information of the patient, but there's someone in your area and they'd like to show up. So he said, absolutely, here's my cell, give it to the patient, have them. And he was able to enjoy the Seder. So I think that really brings out a lot of what this program can do. You can build a real human relationship with your patients and a meaningful relationship with your patients. And there's the actual structure of the program, which is execute on the care plan, make sure that they're making progress and they're taking their meds and all that good stuff. And that's the foundation of the program. But it leads to so much more. When done properly, it really, you're able to build that relationship with your patients. And like I said, that's the key. Because if you have that relationship, you can partner with them to achieve their goals. If they just feel like it's a call that they have to take and they're talked at to for a couple minutes and then they get to hang up, then once again, it's not going to be meaningful on a long-term level to the patient and you're not going to win. So it really gives you the opportunity to create those meaningful relationships with the patients and actually try to have them achieve some of their goals. All right, schedule for periodic review and when applicable, revision of the care plan. And like I said, that should happen at a minimum of once of every 6 months. And this is besides for, of course, the revision of the care plan is aside from documenting. Like she said, if it wasn't documented, it didn't happen, and that's 100% true. The way we like to look at it is not if an audit comes, but when an audit comes. you need to make sure that you have what to show for it, and if you're doing the program well, that should not be a problem. If you find that being an issue, go back to the basics, because you probably need to change something. All right, so let's get to how. We know why we want to do the program. It's better for the patients. It's better for the practice. Everybody wins. We know what the program entails. Let's talk about how to get it done. So there's two ways that you can get this program done. The first way is do it yourself. Start tomorrow, start today, and get it done. So here's a couple bullet points. You're going to want to hire a team of qualified care coordinators. And me personally, what I look for in a care coordinator, beyond their experience and their clinical knowledge, is personality. It's empathy, it's personality. And I tell everybody, you know, that comes into my office, I believe about 80% of communication is face-to-face. And you're typically on the telephone when you're doing chronic care management. So you need to get 100% of your personality into that 20% conduit, if you will, in talking to the patient. And that takes a lot of personality. So look for people that are outgoing, are bubbly, they sound good on the phone, they can be empathetic, and they care for the patients and they can help them out. And then on top of that, you know, they obviously need to have the clinical know-how, but also a great idea is to invest in continued education for them. And I think personally my perfect care coordinator would be if I could go to the hospitality industry and, you know, take an amazing hostess or an amazing hotel front desk or something like that, and then teach them all the clinical stuff to me. I think that would be perfect, because the driver, I think, is personality, but that's neither here nor there. Okay, so hire a team of qualified care coordinators. Make sure that you're training them on CCM processes, care plan creation, and enrollments. Enrollments is a good one to focus in on as well, because as we'll get to, and we spoke about a little earlier, there are a number of bullet points that you need to hit with the patient when you're enrolling them. It needs to be informed consent. You can't just, you know, oh, by the way, we're signing you up and not really tell them anything. They need to understand the value of the program. So that means you need to be able to communicate the value of the program and to be able to have the patient weigh the pros and cons. If there's a copay involved, they need to understand that, but then understand the value that they would get as well in order to make that decision. So the enrollments is kind of a good crossover between sales and care coordination. And I don't mean sleazy sales. I just mean the ability to communicate. Okay, eligibility check workflow. You're going to need to run through your patients, and you're going to want to look for eligible patients for the program. And that list is growing, like I said, being that more and more plans are starting to pay for the program. That list is growing, but you need to go in there and make sure that they have the right insurances that are going to pay, but mainly the correct chronic conditions. Software for documenting and keeping track of the program, very important. A number of EHRs are coming out with modules in order to do chronic care management. There's obviously a lot of vendors. Today we're going to be going through a friend of mine, that's Dan from ThoroughCare. There's also, is it CrossTX? Is that your company? CrossTX is here as well, and I believe they have a platform of their own, right? So definitely go check them out as well, but we're going to be sharing some examples from Dan's ThoroughCare platform. And again, we're looking to give everyone here a framework, how to decide on a good vendor and on a good platform, and make how to be able to make good, educated, and qualified decisions. So, but software is super important, as we'll get to, that'll allow you to time, track, document, timestamp everything that you're doing to make sure that it's all kosher. Billing workflow, that's important as well. Once you finish the claims, how is that getting to the billing team? And I think we are having, Patty is going to be talking about a lot of, she's giving a billing, I believe, presentation. She's going to be touching on some of the specifics of billing, so look out for that. Communication channels between office staff and providers, super important. If a patient has an issue, who's that issue being addressed to? If it's a clinical issue, who's the doctor that it's going to? Is there any specific custom workflow that the that your practice or community health center or RHC wants to implement? If it's non-clinical, if the patient needs an appointment, who's going to take care of that? Can the care coordinator schedule that themselves, or do they send that to Melissa at the front desk? Whatever those workflows are, make sure you work them out in the beginning. And again, you know, with the understanding that the first bit as you launch the program is going to be a learning curve. You'll tweak little workflows and you'll get everything working properly. But here's some of the things that you want to look at the outset. I also have a kind of a longer paper on it at my desk, so feel free to come by the table later on how to implement. Okay, number two is how is leverage a CCM partner. So there are vendors out there, myself included, that will partner with you, and they will take the technology. They'll either they have their own or they leverage it, whatever it is. We use ThoroughCare. And they will stack on top of that a full clinical team and partner with your practice. They will have access to your EHR. They should learn your custom workflows. And they should integrate fully with your practice and get the program done for you from A to Z. So if you're somebody that has staffing challenges or is just not interested in getting the whole list together to get this done, this is a great way to leverage a team that will get it done for you. And as we'll get to, this is a reimbursable event. So this should not cost you anything more. So here's a couple bullet points. Again, the idea here is to give a framework. Obviously, this is what we do. There are many other vendors that do this as well. So I'm not going to, let's try to give a framework of what a good partner should do and what they should not do, just based on a lot of the companies that I've talked to. So they should integrate a trained clinical team with your organization. You should know what they're talking about. If they are barely medical assistants in their living room, in their pajamas, reading off a list, don't do that. Patients will not want to talk to those people. They're not going to be happy. They're going to complain to the office, and no one wins. A good partner should white label the service to you. Very important part of the program is that these are your patients. If a partner is working with you, they should not be taking your patients in any way. So this is your program. Like we said earlier, from a Medicare perspective, the way it is the billing practitioner is the one providing the service. This team is just doing the work. So they are actually working for you, and the service should reflect as much. And that should include the outbound caller ID and inbound IVR should all be white labeled to the organization, your organization. They should create care plans for every patient based on your EHR and according to CMS requirements. Make sure that those care plans check off every box. Initiate outreach to patients on a monthly basis. And again, going back to the IVR, the patients should have a direct callback number to your team. They should be able to, there's also a 24/7 requirement for CCM that the patient should be able to get in touch with their some sort of health care 24/7. But a big part of that is they should have a callback number that goes directly to their nurse. It's such, I can't say enough how important that is to patients, that they should be able to pick up the phone and call somebody and either get, you know, the phone gets picked up right away, or at worst, they leave a message and they get a call back the same day and that person's able to help them out. It is huge for your patients. They will love you for it. They will keep coming back and they will refer their friends and family. Okay, all instances of care are time tracked and documented. If you see a vendor and they give you a billing report and it says, we provided 20 minutes, 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 that is not a good thing. You should see, right? You should see 4 minutes and 32 seconds talking to the patient. You know, 5 minutes and 15 seconds chart review. 2 minutes and 12 seconds of trying the first time and leaving a voicemail. Whatever the care coordination that happens, it's not always the same and it's not always perfect, but it should be documented. Also, use this to jump into getting in touch with the patients. CMS wants you to do this on a monthly basis, and Medicare understands that some months you will not get in touch with the patient. Patient goes on vacation, whatever the reason is. So they CMS's requirements is that you need to at least be, but they want you to keep trying so that the next month you get in touch with the patient. So they give you 6 months. Our policy at our office, I feel like that's too much. We do 3 months, and if you haven't physically, I tell my staff, if you haven't physically spoken to a patient in 3 months, obviously that's with the understanding that you've attempted and you've done all the work. At best case scenario, you've reached out to some family member or caretaker and you know that the patient's there. But if you haven't talked to them in 3 months, on that third month, they should go on hold until something changes with their status. But yeah, every instance of care should be timed, tracked, and documented separately. And that's another thing with these platforms. Typically, every click of the mouse is name stamped and time tracked and all that. So you should have full data trails as much as you want. Coordinate care for clinical and non-clinical patient needs. Like we said, whether it's an emergent need for the patient or whether they simply need an appointment or a refill request or anything like that. Let's do that. Yep. Yes, yeah, for those who didn't hear that, if they're calling the patient last second, you know, trying to cram that in, that's probably a sign of something not good in the organization. Every care coordinator should have the correct amount of patients on their caseload that they can have, the right amount of time and TLC for every patient individually, with a buffer so that when patients call back, they have time for them as well. Absolutely, great point. Coordinate or execute on appointment scheduling, medication referral requests, and other patient needs. And finally, send a billing report monthly with all pertinent information for billing out the claims. This is a great one. We took over a client from somebody, from a different vendor that they were using, and they asked us on the first month, the biller says, can you do me a favor, though? When you send the billing report, can you only send the chronic diagnosis codes? And I said, well, of course, we build the care plan based on the diagnosis codes and it spits out accordingly. And she says, oh, okay, good, because the previous vendor that we were using, you'll love this, they basically were just copy-pasting every diagnosis code in the patient's chart and just dumping that into the file. And now you're asking the poor billing team who's not clinical to figure out which codes are chronic and which ones aren't. So make sure that the information that they're giving you on the billing report is correct and it looks right. Everything that you need to bill should be there. Patient information, diagnosis codes, CPT codes, every applicable CPT code, which for RHCs and FQHCs is pretty simple, it's one. Make sure that's all there. Okay, here's a couple bullet points. I do this thing where I try to talk to a lot of companies in our space. So here's a couple bullet points of things that a good partner should not do. They should not lock you into a contract. Maybe some people argue with that. I believe that they're your patients. They're not the vendor's patients, and if they're doing a good job, the patients will be happy, and you shouldn't have any issues. And if they're not doing a good job, you should not be locked into a contract. Which leads us to the second point. I found in some contracts a creative way to lock you into a contract, so look out for this, is patient minimums. So they say, oh yeah, you know, you can cancel at any time, but you have a patient minimum amount of, I don't know, 5,000 patients, or 1,000 patients, or 500 patients, whatever that number is, that means that if you didn't have that amount of patients or they didn't enroll that amount of patients, you find yourself paying for all those patients, and that's a kind of a creative way to get you locked in there, so look out for that. I don't think there should, as somebody that runs such a company, there shouldn't really be a lot of implementation fees or startup costs or anything like that. All that should be baked into the monthly fee. You should pay for what you see. It should be clean, it should be simple. There shouldn't be any hidden fees or anything that's gonna, you know, that you accidentally signed on and then you find out later. That's not a good thing. You should definitely have full access to whatever they're doing. Remember, these are your patients. So anything that's going on with the patient's care is your business. So that doesn't mean that you have to go in there and look at everything, but you should definitely be given the option and the ability to be in whatever system they're using and see everything that's going on at all times. They should they should not be hiring low-quality, barely trained care coordinators. You'd be surprised that happens. Here's another one that came up a little bit ago. I was talking to a new client, and actually, it's a client that we did not get that went with another company. And We have, long story short, the father is a primary and we didn't get him, but we have his son who's a doctor is on with us, so there's some crossover patients that we talk to. And the patients basically started complaining after a couple months with this other company on the program. And long story short, it came out that the entire team was overseas. And that is illegal. Medicare is pretty clear. Any non-emergency care that is being given to the patients has to be sourced or given within the continental United States. So make sure that you know where their care coordinators are. Finally, a good partner should not charge you for things that you're not getting paid on. Again, value. It should be a valuable program for the patients and a valuable program for the practice, and then it'll work for the vendor. If a good vendor will understand that if one of those two pieces are not working, if the patients aren't finding value and or the practice is not finding value, then it's not going to work. So better work out all the kinks in the workflows and make sure that the billing process is happening. Make sure you're getting paid on it. If you're not getting paid, figure out why. If it's something that's fixable, get that done. If it's not fixable, then either take the patients off the program or whatever you need to do. But you should not be just paying out for a bunch of patients that were serviced and you're not seeing that reimbursement come back. Okay, here's just a couple examples of thorough, like I said, we're gonna give some thorough care examples, but just to give you a picture of what a platform should look like, makes it easy, like I said, to document and track everything. So here would be the different programs. There's about 5 programs, but we're talking about chronic care management today. And as of now, FQHCs and RHCs don't really get paid on RPM. There's kind of a creative way, but nothing straightforward, so we'll focus here. On the left, if you can see that at all, you'll see kind of the bullet points. The way ThoroughCare has it is that this is the way you enroll a patient. So you create the patient profile first, and then you enroll them in a program. When you enroll them, in CCM, you'll see there's 5 checkboxes that need to be checked off that say that you went through that with the patient. Patient agrees to participate in CCM. Patient understands that there may be a copay. Patient understands that they can cancel CCM. Information can be shared with other providers, and only one practitioner can bill for CCM. Make sure that those 5 bullet points the patient fully understands. And then what is the consent method? So you've got verbal and written, and that's an important thing to document as well. And then once that's done, who updated it, what's the start date and all that, if there's any notes you want to throw in there, and then that'll always be on that care plan stamped on there. Once you start the care plan, we'll kind of walk through that a little bit. It goes through all those categories, so it starts with the goals. What are the patient's goals? And these will auto-populate based on the diagnosis codes that you threw in there. So it's not the same for every patient. It's going to be custom to the diagnosis codes that you put in the patient's profile. So then those goals will spit out barriers. All right, what are the barriers to the goals that we talked about? Food doesn't taste good without salt. Like I said earlier, can't understand food labels to check sodium. No energy to exercise regularly. No place to get regular exercise. These are real life challenges. They're real human issues that you should be able to brainstorm with the patient. If there's community resources that you can pull in, like we said earlier, that's our job. Our job is to help the patient in whatever fashion you can. So get into the nitty gritty. Okay, then it goes into symptoms. What are some of the patient's symptoms that they're experiencing, and what are we looking to either reduce or prevent? And again, this is not going to be the same for every patient. It's going to be custom based on those specific diagnoses. Okay, and then expected outcomes. And again, these are really, really human. Stop being afraid that I'll get dizzy or faint. Stop being afraid I'll fall. Stop being afraid I'll have low blood sugar. So what patient, you, not us as the doctor, but you, what are you looking for? How can your life improve by achieving these goals? And these things right here will drive compliance. Because if the patient says, you're right, if I do XYZ, I will feel better. I will stop having these anxieties and fears. Then the patient is going to feel that they want to work with you on their health. And at the end of the day, it's the patient's health. You can do as much as you want, but if the patient's not on the same team, it's not really going to happen. Here's an example of the timer. Once you're in there, you're timing everything and tracking it separately. Here's some examples of some notes. And like we said, everything should be documented. And document as, this isn't in the EHR. In the EHR, you want to keep it to as briefly, all the necessary information, but as briefly as possible. In your own system, feel free to put everything in there. If the patient talked about, you know, that their cat had died and that was giving them, you know, anxieties or whatever it is, put that in there. The more documentation, the better. If anyone's ever coming back and asking questions, you'll have it all here. Here are some of the interventions. So the interventions will spit out based on the patient's care plan, like we said. So, okay, what are these goals? And these are those things that are important to make trackable and measurable. Make them specific. Don't make them too broad. Okay, and then here you should see this is what the actual time documentation should look like. So like I was saying, you see monthly clinical review was 10 minutes. Okay, that's pretty exact. Monthly initial patient-centered care plan, sorry, it's a little blurry here, 4 minutes and 29 seconds. In real life, those two times are probably switched, I'll be honest. Provider review of labs, 5 minutes. Prescription refills, 3 minutes and 15 seconds. Everything should be timed separately. All right, let's get to some reimbursement details. And on the how, once again, look out for Patty's presentation on how to get that done. But the code G0511 this year, 2020, this was increased by 50%, which is really cool. So the new average for RHCs and FQHCs is $76.94. Here's some basic maths on the annual projections. So it is definitely can really drive some revenue down to your bottom line, and more money for the practice equals more investment in the practice, more jobs, more patient care, and that's all very, very important. All right, so conclusion. Is running a CCM program worth it? Absolutely it is. You want to give your patients with chronic health conditions, you want to give them a case manager to help coordinate their care and save the health care system millions of dollars. There's a reason that CMS has just doubled down on this. They started in 2015, they just doubled down by adding in the reimbursement. That shows that it works. This is not just a billing program. If done properly and done meaningfully, this can really help patients. And if it's helping patients, it's going to keep them out of the hospital, it's going to, you know, stop them from unnecessary complications, and that will save Medicare money. And that's why Medicare is going to continue to fund this every year. So by raise of hand, who is currently doing CCM? All right, we've got a handful. If you are not, you now have no excuses. Either do it yourself, get it done, or reach out to myself. You can come by my table. Like I said, there's, you forget, cross the X as well. Do you do clinical teams as well or just software? Okay, so a little different, but go talk to, what's your name? Chandra, for details on their company, but there are many people that can help you. There's really no reason to get it started. Like I said, a good partner, it shouldn't be hard to get it up and running. They should assume all the risk, and you should only see the value of the program. So no excuses, get it done. And finally, this is me. QR code goes to my calendar, and those things are for, we actually started a very cool podcast called Healthcare Trailblazers, and we have some interesting people on. Dr. David Pate, CEO of St. Luke's Health System. We've had Dr. Sanjiv Chopra, who's a really, really cool doctor, talked to him on Friday. We have the chief medical officer of WebMD coming on Monday, I think. So fun conversations. If you're somebody that wants to learn about other people's journey in building really successful healthcare organizations, give it a listen. Otherwise, thank you so much for your time, and get some chronic care management done.